Hi everyone, Aaron here for Zolotech, and Apple released iOS 17 Beta 4 today to developers. iOS 17 Beta 4 is out to developers, and I would expect iOS 17 Public Beta 2 in a day or so. Now it's available on all the supported devices from the iPhone XS all the way up to the iPhone 14 Pro and 14 Pro Max. And along with this, Apple also released iPadOS 17 Beta 4, WatchOS 10 Beta 4, macOS 14 Beta 4, tvOS and HomePod OS 17 Beta 4, as well as VisionOS Beta 2 and Studio Display 17 Beta 4. Now, this particular update was not huge. It was 1.34 gigabytes, that's on the 14 Pro Max, and was about a gigabyte or so on the other devices. Now, let's go ahead and take a look at the build number and talk about what's new. So we'll go to Settings, then we'll go down to General, then About, and if we tap on the version number, you can see the build number of 21A5291H. As we get closer to a final release, typically that letter will get closer to the letter A, then we'll have a release candidate and the final version. And this update has quite a few things to talk about. The first thing is there is a new modem update. So if you're updating from beta 3 re-release or the public beta to public beta 2, you should have a modem update, and hopefully that helps with overall connectivity. Connectivity in iOS 17 in general has just been okay. Hopefully this resolves some of that, but it'll take a few days to know that. As far as new features, there's quite a few new ones. The first one has to do with AirDrop. If we go into Settings, and then we go to General, and then AirDrop, under AirDrop, we have a new option for bringing devices together. We can disable this now where we AirDrop just by bringing our devices close together. I think it's really nice, but if you want to turn it off, you can. And it says easily swap numbers with NameDrop, share photos, and more by holding the top of your iPhone close to another. And by AirDropping from one device to another by just touching the top of them together, you can quickly send a photo or anything else, and it will show up on the other device. You can disable this now if you want to. Within Settings, if we go down to Standby, at the bottom there's a new option for Show Preview on Tap Only. Standby can hide the previews of a notification until you tap on it. So if we have that enabled, and then if we put it on maybe a dock here so we can do standby, we'll just turn the screen off, have it go into standby mode. Once we're in standby, if we get a notification, we'll tap on it and it will let us go into that notification and see what it says. Otherwise, it will hide it and keep it private. Another small change in Settings is the icon for home screen and app library. If we scroll down on beta 3 on the left, you'll see with beta 4 on the right, the icon has been updated and it's a more colorful grid pattern. Within Messages, they've updated the little app icon to the left. If we tap on the plus to the left, they've made things a little bit more consistent. Everything now has a little round icon. The spacing has been updated, and Photos, this one I'm not so sure I like, has been replaced with the Photos app icon instead of the most recent photo. So maybe they'll bring that back with beta 5, but at this point it looks like they've just got the different apps as well. We can again still rearrange things by moving up and down by pressing and holding, and also the little more icon now is round instead of oval. Additionally, that bug still works where if you have it basically as the third icon down and we double tap on it, it will open up whatever is there or nearby. So if you double tap on the button and you have voice memos there or something else nearby, it will actually bring that up. So it usually has to be around the third or fourth icon. Within Safari, if we go to our bookmarks and then go to the option to clear, it's no longer full page or doesn't go all the way to the top. It's a small change, but something they've updated. In the control center, they've updated an icon also. The Apple TV icon in the bottom left is updated with a black circle instead of an outlined circle for the little remote itself. It's a small change, but again, another change. Also in Settings, if we go to Accessibility, under Accessibility, if we go to Display and Text Size, there's a new option for Prefer Horizontal Text. It says Prefer Horizontal Text in languages that support vertical text. So that's an option that you can enable or disable if you want to. Another slight change I noticed is when I went into my battery settings for battery health, I took a screenshot as these typically disappear, but under Insights and Suggestions, I had a new icon for auto brightness. Before, it just showed the little tips app icon. So this has been updated. Just again, another very small slight change. And before we take a look at the release notes, I wanted to give a shout out to the Telegram and Discord communities that we have. I'll link them in the description, as well as Braden and Matt for helping me out as well, finding additional features. Now let's go ahead and take a look at the feedback app. and go to recent activity, and under the latest notes, there are pages and pages of known issues as well as resolved issues. In fact, there's 70 categories of known issues with additional issues under each one of those categories. There's also new features where it says to test new features such as adaptive audio, personalized volume, and conversation awareness, developers need to install AirPods beta firmware. And I've talked about that before. We could see a new update for AirPods firmware, but known issues, tons of different things, as well as 16 categories of resolved issues with 40 resolved issues mentioned. So tons of things in here. And if you're having issues, make sure you check the feedback app and the notes to see if Apple's already aware. If it's not listed here, make sure you submit feedback in the feedback app. But again, known issues for cellular and much, much more. Tons of different changes and updates here. Now, as far as bug fixes we know that seem to be working properly, well, one thing that's great news is the keyboard bug. So the keyboard seems to be very buggy typically on iOS 17 beta 3 and earlier. Now it's showing up properly. We have our icons. If we say hi, we can tap send and everything is here. Sometimes there was a workaround where you had to tap return. The new contacts widget is now working properly. So if you have it set to call someone or maybe message them, tap on the little button there and it opens right up. So it seems to be working as intended. Now, that notification bug, though, is still here. It's jumpy, it doesn't work properly, and just seems to sort of jump around all over the place. So I'm not sure why it does that, but it continues to be an issue and they haven't fixed it yet. Hopefully they see this video and some others complaining about this and resolve it very, very soon. Now, as far as overall performance, it seems to be pretty good despite what Geekbench actually shows, and I'll show you that a little bit later. Performance is nice and fast. You've seen me go into different apps. They open up and load as expected. Different data loads as expected. It's smooth. ProMotion is smooth, and surprisingly, the heat of the device is nice and cool. The back of it is cool to the touch for the most part. It is processing a little bit since we're actually on an early beta and installed it and has to do a bunch of background processes, but for the most part, it's staying nice and cool. As far as battery life, well, we'll have to wait and see. For me, if you've been following along, it hasn't been great. My battery health is down to 92% with many more cycles than we had last year at the same time. Battery life over the past few days, and there's that auto brightness thing I showed you earlier with the tips. If we look at yesterday, I only had 3 hours and 31 minutes of screen active time and 4 hours and 7 minutes of screen idle time and used almost 100% of my battery. That was the camera, even though I didn't use it very much. There's some odd bugs here and there. The day before was almost 2 hours of usage with 50% battery used. So it's really not great in general. Hopefully they fix it with this beta. I know some people have had a better experience than I have though. And if you're wondering if you should install iOS 17 Beta 4 or iOS 17 Public Beta 2 when it's released, I would say if you're on the iOS 17 betas, absolutely. This may be a good time to try it out, as usually by the fourth beta, it's much more stable. Of course, only time will tell, and we'll take a look at that on the weekend with the regular follow-up. But it takes a few days to know what it's like as far as storage and more. And we'll take a look at storage quickly, as some of you have asked about that. We'll wait for it to load. It loaded pretty quickly, and if we scroll to the bottom, you'll see system data is only taking up 1.07 gigabytes. This can vary greatly from 20 to 50 gigabytes and back down. It will use storage as needed. You'll see the system data is only 11.01 gigabytes. When you install an update, it overwrites the previous one and doesn't take up too much additional storage, if any at all. Now, as far as iOS 17 public beta release, like I mentioned, public beta 2 probably later today or tomorrow. The next beta with iOS 17 beta 5 will probably be in 2 weeks. With iOS 15 beta 5 and iOS 16 beta 5, they released in August. August 10th for beta 5 of iOS 15 and August 8th for iOS 16 beta 5. So I think this will be the last 2 week cycle that we have. Then we'll move on to weekly cycles after this based off of the previous years. We also could see iOS 16.7 beta 1 as soon as tomorrow or maybe next week. Typically we'll have an iOS 0.7 update before the release of the next version. So we could see that as the final iOS 16 release before iOS 17 in mid-September. That's usually what we have every year. As far as overall benchmarks, I did run those and they're not great compared to the previous version. If we go in, I already ran it. Let's go into the screenshot that I have. And I actually ran this twice because I had poor results on the multi-core score. You'll see the single core score is 2,616 compared to 2,648 on the previous version. On multi-core, we had 5,960 compared to 6,790. Now, as far as the overall performance in using it, I haven't noticed really any difference. However, the scores actually say otherwise. We could see this change after a few days after it's done processing everything in the background. So I wouldn't really worry about it too much, but it's just worth mentioning. As far as iPadOS 17 Beta 4, if I find anything other than what I've mentioned that's in iOS 17 Beta 4, I'll be sure to mention it in the follow-up as well. But so far, it has the same sort of updates as far as the icons with home screen and app library, and everything else seems to be the same. I haven't really noticed any differences other than the initial differences with iPadOS 17 Beta 1. If I find anything else, though, I'll be sure to share that later this week. And of course, if you'd like to get your hands on this wallpaper, it will be linked in the description as it normally is. If you haven't subscribed already, though, please subscribe. And if you enjoyed the video, please give it a like. As always, thanks for watching. This is Aaron. I'll see you next time.